All right. I'm here with Emma. Emma, how are you doing?
I am doing fantastic. How are you?
Good. Thank you so much for taking the time. I want to jump right into it. What's going to make the most out of our time here today? What are you struggling with? What have you been grappling with? Like, what has maybe been a persistent problem or issue or concern or even just a pattern that you want to talk about or bring up today?
The piece that I would love your advice on, your coaching on, is around connecting with my audience, like right off the bat. And I have created a program and would love to make an epic lead magnet, like that first connection point. And actually, your lead magnets have been the most valuable out of all of them that I've like ever taken. And so wow. I'm excited to talk to you specifically about this, and especially in terms of like how to connect, how to provide like so much value. And for my specific offer, I'm even hoping you could help me like figure out like an epic lead magnet and like how to position it to get people to feel connected and like they want to work further with me.
Mm-hmm. I love it. And the offer that we're selling in one sentence?
It is a pregnancy program to help moms take the best care of themselves so that they thrive through and savor the newborn stage.
Beautiful. Okay. Group or course, or how's that delivered?
There are two levels. So There's a self-paced option that people can take during pregnancy. And there's also a 6 month of support option that people can take starting in pregnancy and taking them through the postpartum stage so that they have that continuous support at all those steps.
Beautiful. You've used a word several times and I want to dive into that. Do you know what word that you've been using several times?
I don't know.
It's good. Connecting or connection. Mm-hmm. And when someone uses a word frequently, it stands out to me because it must mean that that's important to you. So mm-hmm. Let's start with that. You said, you know, the initial prompt was, I want to do something that connects with my audience right off the bat. What do you mean by connecting, and how will you know when that has accomplished? Like, what is connecting with your audience look like for you in your mind?
I think it for me makes someone feel something and like feel like, yes, like this can help me, this can benefit me. And I guess like on the flip side of that, it's like why I value it. It's, I like worry that people don't feel connected to the author or like how I can help people. And like, I've seen some evidence of people, you know, purchasing my program, but it's not like growing at the pace that I would want. So it's making me feel like maybe there's a disconnect somewhere and maybe I'm not connecting the way that I would want to.
Okay, great. So I'm hearing a couple of things that connecting means they feel something as if like, yes, this person and this stuff can help me. Mm-hmm. Okay. And then you're also having an experience where it feels like maybe people aren't having that experience of saying this person and this stuff can help me.
Yeah.
Okay. And that you are having some sales, but it feels like what the connecting means is connecting the dots. Like not connecting, like, I feel so connected to Emma. I just want to be her friend. That's why I ask, because connecting means a lot of things to different people. Right. But I'm hearing that people aren't connecting the dots that this is the information, this is the solution, this is what I need. Is that what you mean by connecting?
Yeah, in this case,
great.
Yes.
So here's what we're going to do, because you have experiences in your life in which you went through free content and you felt very connected. You happened to use myself as an example. So we're going to do a little, you know, reversing the role for a moment. And I want you to think of one of those specific opt-ins, lead magnets, free training that you've gone through where you had an experience where you felt connected, that same experience you want your audience to feel where they go, this is my person, this is the stuff, and this is what's going to make a difference. Do you have a specific example in mind of mine?
The first thing that comes through is first 100 leads.
First 100 leads. Okay, great. Yeah. Did you want to say more?
Yeah. And what helped me specifically, first of all, just the amount of content that you have in there for free product is incredible. And you actually teach us something in every single video. So I would like go through, watch the videos, and then I would have something actionable to be able to do and to try. And I did. So I just thought that was so awesome to actually feel like I learned something and have something to practice in real life.
Great. Okay. So you're hearing what you're saying, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Because you're answering your own question, at least at a 10,000 foot view. So I just want to repeat that back to you. You're saying what I'm looking for is a free training or the first in the front door. I've got their foot in the door, experience, freebie, whatever, that will have my audience feel connected. And by connected, we mean, oh my goodness, this person has the solution. This person can help me. This is the path. And you also said that you had that experience when you went through my stuff and the specific things you said that had you feel that same feeling you want your audience to have is there's a quantity of content delivered for free that you said this like three times, actually teaches something that is actionable that I can go out and try, do, and practice. So if that's what had you feel connected to me, the product, the next step, if you had to guess, because I don't ever want to give anybody the answers, I just want to leave the clues here. What do you think you could start to do for free that would start to have your audience feel like they're getting something that they can take action on, that they could follow, that they could take that first step, apply it, see a result, and start moving in that direction?
Okay. So what is kind of wild is I have created something like that. I've almost finished it, but I haven't put it out into the world yet, around preparing your mindset for birth, reducing fear around it, reducing pain. But I have not put it out or moved forward on it because I'm like, well, birth and postpartum are two different things. So I should be creating something more linked to postpartum, like maybe around beliefs or expectations or something more directly lined up to my product and like the transformation that I help people with. But that's the first thing that popped into my mind.
Okay.
But it's like, yeah.
Good. Let's work with that. So I want to clarify the product itself is to help women through the pregnancy process, not post.
Yeah. Help them set themselves up really for success for the fourth trimester, which is this really vulnerable time, especially for women's mental health.
Did you say the fourth? Did you say the fourth?
I said
first?
The fourth trimester. Okay. So that's actually a few months, you know, the newborn stage, the postpartum stage, the time after your baby is born. It's a pretty vulnerable time. So people can set themselves up for success.
Okay. So what I'm hearing, I totally got you. I'm totally in. So what I'm hearing is the program is for like, baby was just born, now what? Right? That phase. But the freebie is like, you just got pregnant, now what? Right? And so the thinking behind it is that too soon? Am I putting the cart way before the horse? And this is something that's not like relevant or connected. Is that what the concern is with that freebie and putting that out there?
So both of them would be during pregnancy. So both the programs for pregnancy, so for that specific time period. My concern is that the people wanting to know about birth stuff, of course, they're going to go through the fourth trimester, but I might not be lining up the fourth trimester piece as well.
Yeah, I understand that. So what I'm hearing is we're worried that we might be attracting not the most ideal person that's ready for the actual paid program.
Yeah. And the people I would be attracting through the prep for birth piece might not be interested in learning about that next step.
Yeah. Good. Let me just ask a question that may have the same answer, may have a different one. Well, I want to go here first. You said you started creating this. What percentage would you say you're done with it?
Like 90.
Okay. I love it. So we're 90% done. I want to ask this question with a presupposition, like this idea or notion that there's a part of you that wants to put it out there and there's a part of you that doesn't. And I want to talk, and it's usually like this little teeny tiny part of our brain, right? That doesn't want to. That I want to talk to that part of you. What is that part of you that is hesitating on just putting it out there? What is that part of you worried will happen if you do? Like, what's the worst concern or worry that that part of you has if we put this out there?
I feel so vulnerable saying this, but just that I'm not qualified.
That you're not qualified to help women prepare with the birth piece. Yeah. So do you notice when we asked it before, it was kind of like, yeah, it's just maybe a little too separated from the offer. Maybe I'm attracting the wrong people. But then this part of you is actually like, there's a fear of imposter syndrome coming up that maybe I'm not qualified to teach that part. So you see that, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Now here's two things that are the same thing that I want to point out. I asked a couple of questions, and you've probably heard me say a million times, the quality of your life is determined by the quality of questions you ask. And I'm intentionally asking certain questions a certain way to see what just naturally comes up. And you're really good at noticing like what is just kind of, there's the answer. And then you probably notice that there might be a filter to it after it. So at one point in your life, you had the idea to create this and you propelled all the way to 90%. And then on this conversation, that idea popped up again, and it almost felt like an irrational way. It's like, I don't know why, but I just had that idea again. So I guess the question is, are we going to start following through and trusting on our intuition, or are we going to continue to listen to it to the 90% and then stop?
Ooh, yeah, that is huge. I feel like you just hit something major there. I totally have noticed myself going into overthinking mode, overcomplication mode when I have that like intuitive hit that I'm so excited about. And then I stop myself, and like a big piece of it is that fear.
Yeah. Fear of
being seen, being successful, being different.
Yeah. And if you're seen successful and different, then that means what about you? What could that mean about you, or what would happen if that was the case?
That I'm an outsider.
An outsider. That's not such a bad thing.
Oh, it feels like it.
Was there a time in your life when you felt like an outsider before?
Yeah. Yeah. How old? Like I moved to Canada and didn't know anyone.
How old were you?
It was 11. I was 11.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I did feel like an outsider at first.
Yeah. When you were this 11-year-old little girl moving to a new country, I'm assuming, not just new, territory.
Born in Wales. Okay. Yeah. Wow. Born in Wales and moved to Canada. Yeah.
Yeah. And you're 11. And when that happened, and maybe it was hard making friends or didn't have any at first or whatever was that circumstance, what did the 11-year-old girl's brain make all that mean about you from those memories?
It meant that I just like had to try to be likable to feel like I belong.
Yeah. So can you see that that has become part of your success strategy for life?
Yeah. And I've never actually made that link before.
Mm-hmm. That I have to be likable and the success goal is to belong.
Mm-hmm.
And can you see that, yeah, we can talk strategy all day long. That's cool. But can you see how if you've chosen this field, there is nothing about blending in, being a part of the group that is a part of the success that awaits us?
I know.
And as long as the goal is fit in, be likable, don't be an outsider, you'll always be pumping the brakes on what's possible with this.
Yeah. Always. I feel like I've seen like the impact of that. Yeah.
Yeah, you have, because you can take something that was an inspired, like divine guidance to do something, and then you'll stop right at the end. And work becomes a beautiful seduction for us, because as long as you're busy creating that thing, you don't have to actually be out there and showing up. And then we take it to 90%. And then we say, oh, and we come up, fear masks itself as logic for you. So, oh, you know what? It's too much of a disconnect with the audience, and I'm worried I'm going to attract the wrong people. That's bull. I'm worried that someone's going to see me as a fraud. They might see me as I'm not qualified as this. And then that would have me not fit in. So I'll go try something else. I'll go try this thing over here. But there's a simple workaround for this. Okay. And a simple way out. The first piece of it is the awareness of it. So the more aware you're becoming of it, the more it's the part that is driving these ideas, that part of you, that is becoming aware that there's another part that's trying to just keep you safe and fit in. It's still the 11-year-old girl that's trying to keep you safe and fit in, right? But I mean, like, I love to stand out, not because I want attention, but because I want to invite other people to be different. Fitting in is overrated, Emma. Okay. Isn't that funny? Because everyone wants to believe they're special and then fit in at the same time. It's like, you can't have your cake and eat it too. Like, either own your special, own your weird, own your uniqueness, or fit in. But fitting in is not who you are, true or false.
Yeah, true.
You have to compromise your authenticity to fit in, true or false.
Yeah, true.
Right. So that's not who you are.
Mm-hmm.
You are not who you are or need to be in order to fit in. So you are going against yourself when you do that. Mm-hmm. And then there's a bigger thing. Let me ask you this question. Why do you do what you do? Why are you doing this?
A, because I love it. And I just have this like mission in the world to mm-hmm. help people.
Yeah. So those are one and the same. You love it because that's what your higher self or your soul is telling you. That's what you're here to do. And you know it beyond yourself, and you know it in your mind. This is my mission.
Right? Totally.
So it's normal. All of us have the fears and all of that. But I want to remind you that it's a simple choice. Would you rather fit in or fuel this mission? You can't.
Yeah.
Because you can't do
totally
both.
Totally not fuel the mission.
Yeah. Do you see that you're always choosing one or the other? That if we say, well, it's 90%, but I don't know, then we're choosing not to fuel the mission.
Mm-hmm. I didn't look at it like that. I looked at it as though I'm still fueling the mission, but at a slower pace.
Sure. So we're half-assing the mission. Right. But I mean, you want to fuel it with like a bicycle or a freaking rocket ship. That's your choice as well. But here's the thing. You're looking at this freebie or this piece from the lens of, will it work? Am I qualified? Will they like it? And I don't mean any of this disrespectfully, but your strategy for life is totally broken, because your strategy is, I have a big mission and I want to help a ton of women and a ton of moms, and I want to fit in. It's broken. And so that's why I say it's a choice. You either get one or the other. You will not fit in if you are full bore, thrusters on, pedal to the metal in this mission. You will not fit in. You will stand out. You will absolutely be standing out. People will see you differently. People will be blown away by you because the spotlight will be on you in a bigger way. There will be people that love you. There will be people whose lives are changed by you. There will be people who, once they encountered you, their life was never the same. And there will be people that don't like you. There will be people that disagree with you. There will be people that are threatened by you. There will be people that are intimidated by you, even when you're not trying to be, because you're just being more of who you are. And until you are okay with that, that never ends up happening, and we choose fit in.
Mm-hmm.
And when you can get that, the one more person that you could help, one more mom and family, because then it's about a generational thing, that you could impact is more important than 1,000 people's opinion of you, then you will be unstoppable. Because the question is this, take qualified or not out of the equation for a moment. This freebie, if it's in the hands of someone who just got pregnant, will it help them? Yes or no?
Yes.
If it's going to help them, do you feel like they will be more connected to you and your work?
Yes.
There should be absolutely zero reason or zero part of you hesitating and put this out here, because it's not a matter of how qualified or not I am, because if you're going down that hole, there's always another qualification. There's always another degree, credential, certification, book, training, seminar, client, case study, testimonial that your ego will put in front of you like a carrot on a stick, dangling you and saying, you're still not ready yet. Emma, you're still not credible yet. You still need this extra thing. And when we can move that aside, because that's all just the need to look good, because I don't want anyone to judge me, right? I want to fit in. And we just say, if this can help somebody, then it must be put out there,
mm-hmm.
period. Even if it doesn't connect to the offer, it's 90% done. And I knew when I asked that question, you were going to say at least 70%. The way you were describing it was like, this thing is already done. You just need to go boop, 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 launch. The rise of the digital CEO is based on a couple of very simple premises. The first one is business growth happens in stages. In every stage of your growth, you require a different strategy, a different way of being, a different set of thoughts, beliefs, and values. The next thing is the role that you fill determines the results that you receive. So every stage, there is a role required of you. And the last one is the more structure that you have in your business, the more freedom you get back in your life. So at every stage, you're putting the systems, the structure, and the process in place in that business so that you can fill the role you need to graduate to that next role. So what I do in this training is I pop up the hood of our 8-figure-a-year digital product-based business, and I show you how that business runs. And I don't mean it is disrespect to anybody, but learning the latest thing to get you a client or turn your Instagram account into sales does not mean you have a business. And what ends up happening is you end up going down this rabbit hole of reactivity and overworking and exhaustion and franticness. You have just created a self-engineered prison. You are the prisoner. You are held hostage by your own business and you're stuck. I have been there myself. There is a way out. And that's what I'm here to show people, because business is here to give us freedom. It's here to improve the quality of your life. It's here to give you that sense of purpose and fulfillment. And yes, it's here to give you freaking money. And I want to show you how that's done. That is the rise of the digital CEO. Head on over to jameswedmore.com/rise to reserve your seat now. That's www.jameswedmore.com/rise. This is what's really cool. Everything is, there's the synchronicities and beauty of the universe beyond what you and I can comprehend, right? So everything is a part of something. There's that law of correspondence. And so everything is like this reflective holograph, like a parts of the whole and the holes within the parts. Could you imagine that there's a possibility that you getting 90% done with something that you were divinely intuitively inspired to put out is kind of the same metaphorical balance of there is 90% of you in and that 10% of you, that's that part of you that pumps the brakes, right? That the same way it's like manifests in one program. I go 90%, there's a 90% of me, part of me that wants to do this. And then there's the 10% that stops. And if you take that 10% and you bring it to the other 90%, and you know, that's work for you to do. The first piece is to talk to that 11-year-old girl to know that it's okay to stand out, because that's what we're here to do. That we're all different and we're all special, and she was different and she was special then. And that you're safe now. She was safe then and she's okay then. And if you can start to heal that 10% of you, then where you're coming from here on out, is 100% from purpose, from mission, which the goal is to stand out. That's the thing, is people can't have their cake and eat it too. You can't fit in and have a message that stands out. But the people that are successful and the people that go on helping people are the ones that stand out and have a mission and a message that they stand for that allows them to stand out. Make sense?
Totally. I need to lead from that myself, because I'm also expecting the women that are working with me to do something different in themselves, right?
And the big problem that a lot of people find themselves in, and it's a beautiful problem. I've seen this in myself so often. You can't give what you don't have. So I can't talk about these things that I've been talking about with you if I hadn't integrated them with myself. You'd be sitting here going, this guy's full of shit. This guy's just a walking, talking contradiction. But I can share these things because I've integrated those things that I'm sharing with you within myself. So now the tricky thing for all of us is that when we teach something and we go, I'm called to teach this, we must fully learn it and integrate it ourselves. And this becomes the opportunity for you to do that, because you can't give what you don't have. So when you go through this yourself and see this as me learning this and integrating this, means that's how much more powerful I get to pass it on to my students. That is you living in that purpose and in that mission, that you realize that it's not about being qualified or a certain amount of credentials and degrees and stuff like that can go on in perpetuity for the rest of your life. And you're sitting on the sidelines waiting for someone to give you permission to get in the damn game. You can sit there and say, every day and in every way, who I am and how I show up is an example that I can share with others, that I lead by that example, that I'm proof of what's possible, that I'm demonstrating by who I am in the world and what I stand for. And it's that embodiment that just me breathing, just me being there is making a difference and a change for that other person. That me having it within me gives them that permission to do it within themselves. And when you take on life that way, it's pretty amazing. Because you realize every little step that you grow, every new lesson that you integrate is something that you get to pass on to any student, even when you're in a completely different space. You're not teaching business, but you see the parallels to all of it. You're asking them to do things different and to stand out and to go against a lot of norms and traditions the same way that you are doing that exact same theme in your life. So you'll be able to help them so much more when who you are is a stand and a representation for that. Make sense?
Yeah, it does.
Good. Hopefully it'll make more than sense. You know, like it'll be where we live from. You know, only you can do that, right? And that's the choice. So what's coming up for you now, or any questions, or where do you want to go from here? It's up to you. Or we can call it complete. I'd say whatever you want to do.
To me, it's like, I know on a logical level and like, that embodiment work I have been practicing and doing every day, but it feels like I'm not like quite closing the gap. So I'm just wondering if you have like any advice, or even just like from like the words that I'm using, you like.
Yeah. Okay. So yeah, of course. I mean, there's a million things we could do, but you're noticing some things and you're saying, I'm not quite closing the gap. So tell me what that means. Make me get and understand what that means. What is the gap? What is, if a gap presupposes that there's two sides or two ends or two parts. So what are the two parts that we're closing, or what is that gap? Can you fill me in on that?
It's like the intuition and the filter and the example coming up for me is like, say social media, say if I go to do a story, right? Or create a reel.
Yeah.
It's like the intuitive hit to talk about something.
Good.
Right?
Yes.
That comes through. I press record. It's almost like I don't quite, it's like I watch it back and it's like, I could just tell there is a filter there without meaning to, but something happened between that intuitive hit and reading myself.
Good. Good. Beautiful. I'm glad we asked clarification with that, because we could have gone in a million different directions. So what I'm hearing from this is that we're trusting that intuition and we're leading with that, but you're noticing that it's not quite coming out as pure and powerful as it could be.
Yep.
Okay. There's two things here at play. The first is the simple 3D one. Okay. So we'll just get this one out of the way and then we'll go to a more fun one, is practice. Okay. I want you to trust that at some point or another, you're going to have to be okay with a level of like, it's good enough and every day I'm getting better. And there is a skill involved with this. Okay. So, you know me, I like to talk about beliefs and all these types of things, and beliefs play a role, and we're going to get into that, but skills play a role too. If I sat here today and had the intuitive divine inspiration to sit down and play the guitar, and I went and did it, and I sit there and go, gosh, I just don't sound like an amazing musician. It's because I don't have the skill of mastery in the guitar. And you need to remind yourself that communication, presentation, teaching, and putting that all together in a 60-second clip is a skill. And you will get better at any skill when you do two things: when you have the right strategies and you practice. So you get better. So that's the like 3D piece of it. And maybe that's a part of it. Maybe it's just like, you know what? The more I'm practicing this, the more present I'm going to be. Because part of the skills of presenting that people don't really talk about is, are you grounded and are you present as you speak? Or are you in your head trying to just say what you're trying to say? I'm not in my head right now. I'm here. I'm with you and I'm present and I'm grounded. And so what's coming through is whatever's coming through in the moment. And I'm just letting it come through. And when we're new and we don't have the practice or experience, it tends to be a little bit more like, what was it that I was trying to say? And you're almost like looking up the whole time, like trying to see inside your brain. Like, I'm trying to say this thing that I had this idea to say it and I had it right in my mind. And that is one of the things that I'm talking about. And when we are practicing our presenting, so a lot of people don't know this, but I've been doing this for 16 years. I've made hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of videos, hundreds of podcasts. I've been on so many webinars and presentations and speaking on stages that it's very natural for me to get the little me out of the way, get the thinking bit out of the way, and not let the brain do the presentation, but let it flow through me in a way that it needs to come through. That does take practice. That makes sense, right? So you go log 1,000 hours of teaching in small bits and you will come and tell me a different story than you are right now. Okay. So to expect that I'm going to have this like intuitive nudge and just be the masterful person would be putting some pretty high expectations on you, but it's also a good indicator, Emma, because when you have high standards, that's also your higher self telling you, oh, this is just the beginning and you're going to go to bigger heights. Is that true or false?
Yeah, I feel that completely.
Good.
Everything you're saying, I'm like, yes. And I've seen evidence of getting better already. And I have the intention of getting better and learning along the way. So
You're doing just fine right now on here. So now the second piece, which is the context in which we speak. Okay. So context is huge. Context in this context means the cognitive lens. So I'm going to use a quick metaphor for you and then we're going to see. Okay. So as I use this metaphor, I want you to think of a specific memory of a time in which you went to go create one of these reels and it just didn't feel like it should have felt, okay? So you're just going to use a specific example in your mind as I share the metaphor. So the great metaphor of the cognitive lens is that experience you have that we've all had when you go like skiing or snowboarding, you go to the mountains and you put on those polarized goggles and you put them on and everything looks orange, like the snow is orange, the sky is orange, and the trees are orange. And then you ski all day, whoosh, 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 having a great time. And then you go to lunch and you take the goggles off and you're like, whoa, everything's bright again, right? We've had that experience. You forgot about the orange. And so the lens and your perception became one and the same. So the goggles or the lens and our perception became one and the same, and they were no longer distinguishable. They were indistinguishable from each other. Nothing in life exists void of a context. We really don't have, there are moments in our life. Okay. There's moments, one of those moments would be when you have a baby and you're looking at the eyes of that baby and all you see is God. And it's in those fleeting moments where you see life through no lens, but through pure perception. And that's when you see the beauty of the infinite and the divine all around us. And we have those as moments, but the fact that they're only moments prove that for the majority of our days, we experience life filtered through a lens. And I'd like us to consider that even when we go and do a video or a reel, when we're speaking, we're having an experience through a cognitive lens or perception. If you had to guess, what was that cognitive lens, context, or perspective in which you did that reel?
I don't know why this popped into my head. Like school, like just like having to speak a certain way. So I was in school for a long time. I did my master's, I did my PhD. I had to speak in certain ways, write in certain ways. There was a right way and a wrong way, and it wasn't my voice. Mm-hmm. That's what came through for me.
There you go. Wow, that's beautiful. So I have to do this a certain way, and the certain way is the right way, and the most important piece is, and that's not my voice. This is going to go full circle for you, Emma, because I think what you're noticing intuitively, that there's a reason why you've been using the word connection this whole time. And that connection will not happen. Not just connecting the dots. Oh, Emma's my gal and Emma's got she's got the bee's knees. She's got the stuff that's going to help me. Connecting with your message. And if it's not coming from you, unadulterated, the way that you need to do it, they ain't ever going to connect. The way you were taught in school will not have them actually authentically connect with you. Mm-hmm. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So if that's the lens through which, okay, here's here's the right way that I was taught that I have to do. And this will probably also have me fit in too, because I want to be the good girl and get the good grades and be successful and all that type of stuff. And here's this guy over here saying, no, we actually have to throw all that to the curb because that was school. And this is a very different context. This is a very different environment here. What context could you put yourself in for your next reel that would have you know and feel that that voice is your unique authenticity, that is your unique style, that the voice and what comes out of your mouth is the unadulterated frequency from within your heart without any editing, without any filtering or any watering down? What context would you need to put yourself in order for that to be the inevitable default expression of how you show up for your people?
I think of my living room and just like being on my couch, wearing like comfy clothes and just like sitting on my couch and just like chatting as though I was just like talking to a friend.
Yes. And that friend is sitting on the edge, desperate, dying for your guidance, right? They are like in pain and that whatever pain that is, it could be total fear. My life just completely changed, Emma. My old life, I can't go back to. I have no idea what I'm doing. I'm scared out of my mind. And everything I'm reading and learning about is overwhelming. And it just seems to go against everything that I feel to be true within me. Mm. Help me. Now,
favorite people to help, because yeah. It's like, trust yourself, right? Yeah. And I get to trust myself too.
Yeah. And how much easier, like I said before, will they be able to trust themselves when you show them what trusting yourself looks like?
Mm-hmm.
So when you do that next reel, are we getting into the context of I'm the A students, got to fit in and do it right? Because you don't do that if I was your person and we were sitting on the couch, you don't do that, right?
No. And you know what's wild? Before I even fully knew what was going to happen with this program, I filmed it from my couch. Every video is like that comfy vibe. And I haven't necessarily been doing that to share about it. And I need to go back to the essence like that.
Yes. And it's actually a very simple reason why in this context, inside the program, you've done it. But when it comes to social, you haven't. And you know the reason. Tell me the reason why you've made it different.
Yeah, that filter, that part of me, that fear part of me has taken over the bigger mission, but I can...
Yes, but why is it doing it on Instagram and not in the program? Why does the fear piece not get taken over inside the program, but it does on Instagram?
The program was like my mission and the Instagram is like now putting it out and like being seen.
Exactly. Like the only people that are going to see the program are the people that are already enrolled in the mission. It's safer and smaller. We could only have like 50 people in, but it could be 50 million that see it over on Instagram, right? So the fear comes in when it's like, whoa, the numbers, the amount of people, the speed in which they can see this and share it and comment and talk back to it. And that becomes like this huge, dangerous place where we have to dim our light and filter what we say and shrink down or hesitate and not do it at all. But we know at least conceptually. So now you know what's happening. And then we know it's just a choice. Okay. But we know without a shadow of a doubt that it's the playing the small or doing it that old way, the watered down, filtered down that feels like you haven't closed the gap with your performance and content on social that will never have you getting the sales that you want inside the program, which means showing up this new way, the way you know how to show up so that you connect with them is the way you'll get people into the program.
Mm-hmm.
So you started this whole thing with how do I get my people to connect? How do I get them to feel connected? What's the answer in one sentence?
Connect within myself and share that.
1000%, A+. Wow. The perfect student, you fit right in. In and out. You will fit right in by standing out, Emma. The more you stand out, you'll fit in my world.
I love that. I love that so much.
That's awesome. So we'll just end with like, what's one action item? If you're feeling this and it's like clicking, I didn't tell you anything you didn't know. True?
No,
yeah.
I don't know. Everything you said resonated and I like felt it, but yeah. Some things you did connect some dots that I haven't really put together before.
Right. I might've connected dots, but the dots were there. We're just connecting them a little bit more and we're connecting and you can go and connect some dots with your people, which is amazing. So it didn't seem like I'd like taught, whoa, I didn't know that. Right. It was just like, oh, I knew this and I knew this and I didn't see that they were not correlated and connected. Now you do. We see a little bit clearer with this. Even if it's a subtle little change, you, Emma, have to take full freaking advantage of this. Because what I want to say, and I want to say this to anybody, when you have a session like this, it could just feel like a little 5% click, right? You're not like a completely different person. You're just more of who you really are that you're connecting with yourself. It's going to feel like a 5% little change. And there's this powerful metaphor you've probably heard before of the plane that leaves LAX to go to JFK, New York, in America. And if it's 5 degrees or less off, just a few degrees off, by the time it goes from the West Coast to the East Coast, it's hundreds of miles off course. Maybe you've heard these metaphors before. So the opposite becomes true, which is sometimes it's just a 3 to 5% degree shift that ends up putting us from way off course to back on course. And so people discredit these little things. They also assume that it's permanent, like I've done something and now you're changed. I haven't done anything. It's always you. And how you utilize this will make or break you. Because the way I like to look at it is you're always in a battle or a fight from the old you versus the new you. And if we sit on this, you will go back to a little bit more. And like in a month, you'll feel like, yeah, I still feel like I'm not closing the gap. I feel like there's still this, I get 90% and I stop. And then we'll go on an adventure and we'll look for someone who's got some magic healing. You know, okay, there, you're dead, right? And it will be the same thing over and over again. And instead, what I know to be true is that if you now, it's like an opening, it's this little clearing, this little space, and you act from this place now and do the thing that maybe an hour ago you wouldn't have, or 33 minutes ago you wouldn't have done, that's how you will close the gap. This I know to be true as well. Once you close that gap, you've learned that lesson. You've conquered that little battle and there's no going back. You can't unlearn what you just learned through experience, what you've just integrated. You don't unlearn that and you take that with you and that will continue to set you on a new trajectory. So with all that being said, Emma, what's a powerful new action that you are going to take by taking everything from this call that will close the gap for you? And what are you going to do in the next 72 hours or less?
This sounds so silly, but it feels so good. Actually, it doesn't sound silly. It makes sense. I'm going to film a reel from my couch and commit to doing that like every day for the next like 30 days.
I love it.
So out of my comfort zone, but I'm just going to do it.
Yes, you're just going to do it. That's awesome. And when one of those days inevitably comes when you feel like, oh, maybe I should stop or give up, what is something that you can tell yourself then that will keep you in your commitment and your word to doing a reel a day for 30 days?
That commitment to that little gap and the window, like this 30 days is my window.
Yes. That's beautiful, Emma. I love it. Fantastic. Where can we connect with you to follow your 30 days of awesome reels?
Hey, follow me along at My Lighter Way on Instagram.
My Lighter Way?
My Lighter Way.
I love it. Spelled like L-I-G-H-T-E-R.
Yes.
Beautiful. Okay. We're going to link that up in the show notes for you. Emma, you're amazing. Don't you dare squander the gifts and the tools that you have, because there's a lot of women that need it. There's a lot of new moms that need it. And I want you to remind yourself of that every day. It is a privilege and a huge responsibility to do what you're doing. Don't take it lightly and don't squander it. Every day you have an opportunity to make profound difference on someone's life. And we have to remind ourselves of that every single day. And
so much.
Keep doing that. Okay. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you.
You're amazing. So awesome. Every year I do a free live training that rivals most paid programs. It is the one time of year that I pull back the curtain, pop open the hood, and show you everything we do to run an 8-figure a year online expert digital business. So whether you're just starting out, or you've been at this at some time, but you feel like you've been struggling, yet you're meant for more, save the date in your calendar right now for June 1st, because it's time for the rise of the digital CEO. Head on over to jameswedmore.com/rise to reserve your seat now. That's www.jameswedmore.com/rise. I'm going to show you the four phases of online business so you can diagnose and assess what phase you're in and the proper strategy you need to graduate to the next phase so you can continue to see progress and growth in your business. I'll also show you the five essential gears your business needs plugged and in place in order to see profitability, performance, and growth. And lastly, you'll see what today's online experts are doing differently to thrive and remain profitable. Everything from the latest trends to strategies to what's working now. This is the must-attend event for online experts everywhere. This is the rise of the digital CEO.